The Australian Timothy Weeks, who is finally coming home, freed from captivity after being held hostage by the Taliban for more than 3 years. Nine's Europe correspondent Sophie Walsh joins us now with more on this one. Sophie, it's certainly been a long process.
It has. These negotiations have been going on for more than 3 years, but 50-year-old Professor Tim Weeks, who's from Wagga Wagga in New South Wales, is finally in safe hands and on his way to medical treatment as we speak. He was released to US authorities this morning in southern Afghanistan alongside his American colleague Kevin King. They'd spent three years in captivity after being kidnapped by the Taliban at gunpoint outside the university they were teaching at. Today's release was part of a prisoner swap, so it has come at a cost. In exchange, the Afghanistan government has had to release three high-ranking members of the Taliban, so three terrorists back into the world. We just got an update, though, on Tim's condition.
The American and Australian, we understand, have been taken to Bagram Air Base and will be later on flown to Germany for medical checks. So they're in safe custody, we understand, and we understand in good health. But, yeah, there's a very carefully choreographed series of moves, and the main thing is they're safe.
Incredible news, and Tim's family has released a statement this morning saying that they are overjoyed that he's coming home. Tom?
Fantastic news for them. Sophie Walsh there in London, thank you.
Fire and heat are causing major problems right across the country this morning. Teams of volunteers in New South Wales, Queensland, South Australia and Victoria are either battling blazes already burning or preparing to hit the front lines as temperatures rise dramatically to heatwave conditions. We have special coverage of the crisis from our reporters right around the country. Let's go first to Today reporter Gabrielle Boyle, who's at Colo Heights, northwest of Sydney. Gabby, authorities there, they're gaining the upper hand.
Yeah, they certainly have, Deb, but it's been a very busy night for them. If you're in Sydney itself this morning, however, and you're waking to that very thick smoke, you can blame the fire that you can see behind me. Still little patches burning in the bushland here, but certainly fire crews have had a great deal of success overnight. You can see three fire trucks here, one on the other side of the road. These guys have come up from Wollongong, the Illawarra, Bulleye, that area to help out because exhausted crews have been on this fire front for several days. The guys you can see laying on the ground behind me, just getting a bit of R&R there, having a snack, having some water. They've been fighting this fire right throughout the night. They're on a 12-hour shift. You can only imagine how exhausting it must be for them fighting these fires throughout the night. Thick, dirty smoke, really poor visibility. It's been a long night, but they've had a great deal of success. They've stopped a fire spreading throughout a school. It's just up the road. They've also protected the RFS building and a number of houses, including the one you can see to my left here. It's burned dangerously close to this property, to sheds, to farming equipment, to cars. So they've done a great job here overnight. It's settling down here today. We are expecting temperatures to be in the 20s, which is great news. But of course, as I've been telling you this morning, throughout the morning, it's not expected to stay this way. By tomorrow afternoon, parts of Western Sydney will jump up to the high 30s again. So it's going to be another very...
We've lost our link there to Gabby Boyle. Yes, phenomenal work from our fire crews, that is for sure.
We'll go now to Lizzie Pearl, who joins us from Wauchope in the States North. Lizzie, take us through how crews are gearing up there today.
Hey, good morning to you, Tom. Well, this is the RFS HQ staging area. Basically, we are surrounded by fires here in Wauchope. They're burning to the east of us towards Port Macquarie and also to the west of us, where the sheer landmass where these fires have already munched through is almost unimaginable. Yesterday, we saw firsthand just how hard these guys are working on the ground. The locals call it the witching hour, around that 3 o'clock time where the winds really pick up and they seem to blow in all directions. We saw the fire spot over the Oxley Highway and head towards a home. Thankfully, the crews were able to get in there very quickly and save that home. And this is what these guys have been doing on the ground for weeks. Further north of us, the Bora Ridge Fire, which is burning up towards on the in the north of the state. That's the one that really caused a lot of headaches for fire crews yesterday. Our homes were evacuated. That fire has eased overnight, but there are still some concerns for the town of Whippery. And what happens today will really determine what fire crews are able to do in terms of protecting our homes around there. The temperatures today, expected in the high 20s, around the 20 to 30 k an hour winds. Tomorrow, our winds are expected to pick up again. Tom.
All right, Lizzie, thank you. And further north from there, Queensland authorities are also on high alert this morning with bushfires ravaging the state, choking the air with smoke and forcing plenty of residents from their homes. There is a fire burning on Moreton Island that's causing plenty of concern for fire crews. And there's another one at Peachey that has already destroyed several homes.
To South Australia now, Nine's Natasha Kramer is at the state where they're facing scorching temperatures, a real danger. Natasha, it is causing schools to close already.
Yeah, that's right, Deb. Crayford's Primary here in the Adelaide Hills is one of more than 100 schools forced to close today as those extreme heats and strong winds sweep the state. Adelaide is set to tip 42 degrees, but we could break a record which was set in 1962 of 42.7. The extreme heat and strong winds have prompted a statewide fire ban. Seven of those 15 districts in the state are warning catastrophic fire dangers. Now, residents are on high alert, as are authorities, and we're just being told to be not complacent and have those bushfire survival plans at the ready.
Yeah, Deb? Important advice. Natasha, thank you.
We'll go now to Today Melbourne reporter Christina Hearn. Chris, certainly going to be a sweltering few days in Victoria as well.
Tom, that's right. Hard to believe it at the moment, but the temperature will rise to 32 degrees today in Melbourne, much hotter in the north of the state. Mildura, a top of 43. As such, a total fire ban has been declared for the Mallee region. It's our real fire danger day, though, is going to be tomorrow. Top of 39 here in the city with gusty northerly winds. Of course, our firefighters will once again be on alert. They did receive a big boost yesterday, however, with one of the biggest bands in the world, U2, taking the time to say hello at the Melbourne airport as the volunteers prepared to fly to New South Wales to help out with the bushfires there.
It wasn't just being, you know, nice. We really wanted to say it. We really meant it.
Later, U2 tweeted that it was an honour to meet the CFA heroes. Tom?
Yeah, great little boost of support there. Christina Hearn and our team of reporters, thank you.
Road and rail projects worth almost $4 billion will be fast-tracked to help boost the faltering economy. Nine's political reporter Fiona Willen has more for us in Canberra. Sophie, what are the details on this spend?
Well, Deb, this is all about giving the economy a bit of a kickstart. It has been sluggish and other attempts at stimulating it recently haven't done the trick. So the federal government has been under pressure to do more, in particular by fast-tracking major road and rail projects. So that's happening. In a speech in Sydney tonight, Scott Morrison will announce plans to fast-track spending of $3.8 billion. So the government had already committed to spending $100 billion on infrastructure over a decade, but this will see some of that spending happen sooner. So there'll be nearly $3 billion brought forward, plus $1 billion in new money. The federal government will do this by striking deals with the states and territories to quicken the pace of construction for jobs that are in the pipeline. Deb?
And Prime Minister Scott Morrison will join us in the next 10 minutes. Fee Willen in Canberra. Thank you.
Police have declared a crime scene on a quiet suburban street in Brisbane South after two people were found dead. Today, Queensland reporter Jess Millwood is following the investigation for us. Jess, it's thought the pair were actually brother and sister.
That's right, Tom. And tragically, it was their frail, elderly mother that found the pair here in the Sunnybank Hills property yesterday afternoon. Their mother, 89 years old, came to the home. She found the bodies of her children, a 58-year-old woman and a 54-year-old man. It's believed that they'd been inside the property for quite some time. There were no visible injuries on the pair, and police are still working to determine a cause of death. Their mother yelled to neighbours and they called emergency services. Police have been guarding the property ever since. They are still investigating, but they're not ruling anything out, including the possibility, Tom, that this may be a murder-suicide. They continue to guard the property here this morning.
Yeah, just an awful story there. Jess Millwood, thank you.
It seems Donald Trump is keeping quite the eye on the impeachment inquiry against him, slamming the two key witnesses who testified this morning. Jessica Williams and Army Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Vindman have just finished giving their first-hand accounts of what they heard on the call between the US and Ukraine leaders.
They heard a conversation of a conversation of another conversation that was had by the president. What's going on is a disgrace, and it's an embarrassment to our nation.
The National Security Aides have described that conversation as inappropriate and unusual. And staying with US politics, well, sort of, have a listen to this. This live interview with Congressman Eric Saul talking about Donald Trump. It all went quite well until this.
that the president used taxpayer dollars to ask the Ukrainians to help him cheat an election.
Yeah. He claims it was a glass moving on a table. Politicians, we know, though, have a lot of hot air. And the network is defending him. Of course, the clip, it's gone viral, as you'd expect. And, yeah, he's getting a lot more attention than he would have ever imagined. Can we hear it again, just for good measure, just because it'll give us a bit
of a
smile?
Ask the Ukrainians to help him cheat an election.
There you go. Pardon me.
Whoops.
Oopsie. Rennie's fessed up that that's what he's been doing on the desk. Silent but deadly.
Is it time for another coffee? Yeah. There we go. Time for sport.
There. Hey. Don't pause.
All right, let's get into the Davis Cup. It's in full swing and Nick Kyrgios says his serve pleased him the most. Nothing else. In his first up win over Colombia's Alejandro Gonzalez, Nick cut a calm but focused figure on court in a match where he might have usually become distracted and lost his cool against a similarly lowly ranked opponent. Alex de Minaur has kept it running as well. In fact, he's just about to close it out and it's currently 5-1 in the second set after he took out the first set 6-4. The doubles pairing, John Peers and Jordan Thompson, will follow this match against the world's number one ranked Colombian duo. Games and sets won are still very important though, so it's important that the Aussies hopefully get the win there to make sure they can make it through to the quarterfinals. To cricketer Mitchell Starc will return to the Test 11 for Australia's first match at the Gabba starting tomorrow. The left armer was overlooked in four of the five Ashes tests. Coach Justin Langer all but confirmed Michael Nisa and Cameron Bancroft are the two players set to miss. Four Oli Roos players have been suspended from representing Australia after an incident with a woman while on tour in Cambodia. A-League players Nathaniel Atkinson, Lachlan Wales, Brandon Wilson and Riley McGree allegedly broke team curfew when one of the men organised to meet a woman via social messaging app Tinder. McGree, though, can still make the Olympic team if Australia qualifies. His ban expires in April next year. And breaking news from the English soccer. In the Premier League, heavyweights Tottenham Hotspur has sacked manager Maurizio Pochettino. Spurs have had a very ordinary start to the season and sit 14th after 12 games. The Argentinian had five full seasons in charge and famously took Tottenham to the Champions League final earlier this year. Still, only a third of the way through the season. Pretty brutal stuff.